For nearly 70 years, the B-52 Stratofortress has been the backbone of the United States Strategic Bomber Force. It's flown in more conflicts than any other aircraft, from a nuclear deterrent at the height of Cold War tensions to a low-level bomber in Vietnam. It's even served as a mothership for NASA's rocket-powered experimental aircraft. While Buff, Big Ugly Fat Fella, as it's known to its politer crews, may not be the easiest or most glamorous aircraft to fly, no other bomber can lay claim to such a long and distinguished service record. A new engine overhaul will potentially see the B-52 remain in service until at least the 2050s, at which point the airframes will be around 100 years old. So how has the B-52 outlasted the bombers designed to replace it? And what role can a centenarian bomber play in the Air Force of the future? To answer these questions, we have to go inside the aircraft. But first, we need to understand the lineage of this legendary machine. The very notion of the heavy bomber has been part of the American military mindset since 1935, when the Boeing B-17 first graced the skies. This flying fortress impressed on US planners the potential of sending formations of self-defending bombers to attack strategic targets. While the days of 1,000 bomber formations came and went with the end of the war in Europe, the conflict's final act pressed home the need for a heavy bomber capable of carrying nuclear warheads to a target anywhere in the world. Boeing's B-29 Superfortress, which dropped the atomic bombs, had advanced the big bomber design in a new direction. Its pressurized crew compartments, remotely controlled gun turrets, and powerful engines laid the groundwork for the jet bombers that followed. It also gave Boeing the war-proven experience it needed to think bigger, much bigger. Just months after the Second World War had ended, the US military opened a competition for a new long-range strategic bomber. The proposal from Boeing for a straight-winged aircraft powered by 6 turboprop engines was declared the winner. The B-52's painful and protracted development process had begun. Over the next 5 years, Boeing would be forced back to the drawing board time and time again. At one point, the company was even pushed to consider a flying wing design, like the one being tested by the Northrop Company. And then, in late 1947, the B-52 program was almost scrapped completely, despite $4 million having already been spent on it. On October 21st, 1948, the Boeing engineers were given a weekend to come up with a viable design. But luckily for them, there'd been two pivotal advancements in technology: the Pratt & Whitney J57 turbojet engine and the development of in-flight refueling. On the Monday, Boeing submitted a 33-page proposal for an all-jet bomber. The new airframe was heavily based on the company's B-47 Stratojet. Powering this huge jet were 8 turbojet engines housed in 4 underwing pods. Finally, US Air Force chiefs signed off on the design, with the caveat that the tandem seating be changed to side-by-side seating to reduce crew fatigue. After flying the B-52 for its first test flight in 1952, pilot Tex Johnston concluded, "I am convinced that this is not only a good airplane, it is a hell of a good airplane." The B-52 entered service with Strategic Air Command in April 1955 as an atomic bomb carrier. A total of 744 B-52s were built before production ceased in 1962. During the 8 years of production, the design underwent numerous alterations, finishing up with the H model, the only variant that is still in service today. The B-52 you see behind me is a D variant. It was delivered to the US Air Force in October 1957 from the Boeing plant at Wichita. You can see that it carries the camouflage paint scheme it would have worn in Vietnam. To give you an idea of the scale of the B-52, the 0.005 inches of paint covering these 185-foot wings weighs a whopping 275 pounds, or 125 kilos. On each wing, we have 4 pods, each housing a pair of Pratt & Whitney J57 turbojet engines, producing 10,500 pounds of thrust each. When the B-52 was fully laden with fuel, it would need additional wheels at the end of the wingtips to stop them from hitting the ground on takeoff. Next to the engines is the external pylon mount. There you could attach a range of equipment, including additional bombs, missiles, and even other aircraft. Over its career, the B-52 has been the mothership for various aircraft, including NASA's X-15 hypersonic rocket-powered plane. But to truly understand why the B-52 has had such an impressive service record, we need to get inside the aircraft. Three factors have combined to give the B-52 its impressive lifespan. The first is the adaptability of the original design. The B-52 is extremely over-engineered by modern standards. It's a large, heavy aircraft, which has given subsequent engineers greater design margins to work with. Outdated equipment can be replaced without threatening the viability of the aircraft. It's also more generic than its modern contemporaries, and can be adapted to a wider range of missions. The second reason for the B-52's longevity is the cooperation between Boeing and the US Air Force in carrying out modifications to keep the B-52 viable. We can see this throughout the aircraft, with these bundles of cables added to the aircraft with each upgrade. In its 24-year service, this particular aircraft underwent 4 overhauls. Rather than replacing the wiring from each of these modifications, the engineers simply added to what was already there. Upgrades to avionics, weapons systems, and other subsystems have allowed the B-52 to keep pace with evolving mission needs. The third reason is the crew concept. Due to the great lengths of time that B-52s can be in the air, crew compatibility is vital. B-52 crews have trained together as a single unit, ensuring maximum efficiency in the air. This B-52 would have had a crew of 6. The aircraft commander and co-pilot would have sat here in the flight deck. Both pilots would be monitoring this busy control panel, which has instruments for each of the 8 engines. We also have 8 throttle levers so that the pilot could make precise adjustments to each engine. These windows above me would have been used to position the aircraft for air-to-air refueling. Behind the pilots sat the electronic warfare officer, who had the important responsibility of keeping the aircraft out of danger. In the lower deck crew compartment sat the navigator, who ensured the aircraft was following the set flight plan, and the bombardier/radar navigator, who used radar to detect targets and release munitions. Unfortunately, much of the avionics were classified and were removed prior to the aircraft arriving at Duxford in 1983. Above them was the special weapons release, which would have been used to drop nuclear weapons. Other crew members had switches at their positions, which would have been used to consent to a nuclear weapons drop. All of the positions in the aircraft had ejector seats. The ones on the lower deck fired downwards, while the seats on the flight deck fired upwards. The 6th crew member was located in the tail gun position at the end of the aircraft. The tail gun was equipped with 4 50 caliber M3 machine guns, similar to those fitted to B-17s during World War II. The G&H models had a centralised fire control system that relieved the gunner from this lonely position in the tail of the aircraft. In later years, the tail gun was removed completely. While it's not exactly first-class travel, the B-52 had some very modest comforts. There's a toilet on board, as well as urinals. One bunk is located behind the flight deck. There's hot food storage and even cup warmers. But the B-52 demands a lot from its crews in challenging conditions. The cabin temperature would have fluctuated from freezing cold to uncomfortably hot. The pressurised air was dry and the noise levels extremely high. Not to mention the sheer exhaustion exerted on the crews on missions that could last more than 24 hours. The B-52D had a combat range of 6,400 miles and could also be refuelled from the air. This long range was important for the aircraft's first deployment as part of Operation Chrome Dome. Between 1961 and 1968, Strategic Air Command ensured that at any given moment, there were always thermonuclear-armed B-52s airborne, flying routes that would put them within striking distance of the Soviet Union. This would keep the B-52 safe from a nuclear attack, as well as giving the US the best chance of quickly retaliating against the Soviet threat. Missions typically lasted 24 hours and were exhausting for the crews involved. The operation was also incredibly risky. Several nuclear-armed B-52s were involved in accidents during Chrome Dome, culminating in a diplomatic nightmare when a B-52 crashed in Greenland in January 1968, spilling nuclear debris onto the ice. Operation Chrome Dome was shut down the following day. The end of high-altitude nuclear patrols coincided with a change of mission for the B-52. It would now be used as a low-level conventional bomber, flying below radar detection to deliver massive payloads on enemy targets. From 1965, B-52s were deployed to Southeast Asia. In preparation for this long-term deployment, B-52Ds like this one entered the Big Belly modification program, to increase the aircraft's maximum bomb load to 60,000 pounds. In June 1968, this aircraft was deployed to Thailand, where it took part in operations over Vietnam. The 200 painted bombs on the nose represent the 200 bombing missions that this aircraft took part in during the Vietnam War. Some of these took place in December 1972, when more than 200 B-52s took part in Operation Linebacker 2. Over 12 days, 20,000 tons of bombs were dropped on North Vietnam in what was the largest bombing campaign involving heavy bombers since the Second World War. The bombings destroyed huge areas of Hanoi and led to an estimated 1,600 civilian casualties. The campaign also resulted in the highest ever loss of B-52s in combat. 15 Buffs were shot down and 33 airmen lost in the Christmas bombings. The next chapter in the combat career of the B-52 came in 1991. During Desert Storm, Buffs dropped 27,000 tons of munitions, which amounted to 30% of the overall Gulf War tonnage. Despite their advancing years, B-52s maintained a mission-capable rate of 86% and suffered no combat losses. However, it's also worth noting that this wouldn't have been possible had the coalition not already achieved air supremacy in the first few days of the conflict. During the Gulf War, B-52s were also used as a psychological weapon. Before the bombing began, B-52 aircrews dropped leaflets to warn Iraqi forces that the B-52s were coming. Interviews with Iraqi POWs suggested that as many as 24% of them had deserted due to the threat of B-52s. During 26 years of US Air Force service, this B-52 amassed over 14,000 hours flying time before being retired in 1983. The B-52 is not only the largest aircraft in the IWM's collection, but also the heaviest aircraft to land at Duxford. Before arriving in 1983, no record existed of a B-52 using such a short runway to land. Precautions taken included a minimum fuel load and a brief closure of the M11 motorway next to the airfield. Thankfully, Lieutenant Colonel James Merger safely touched the giant down at his new home. In the 35 years that this B-52 has been a museum exhibit here at Duxford, its contemporaries have racked up even more combat hours. In the 21st century, B-52s have been used in Afghanistan and Syria, where they carried out precision-guided attacks against the Taliban and ISIS. As of 2022, there were 72 B-52Hs still in service, all built between 1961 and 1962. They currently serve with the Air Force Global Strike Command to carry out a range of missions, from ocean surveillance to close ground support. But these operations have only been made viable by numerous overhauls and upgrades to the antiquated bombers. At this very moment, the Air Force is preparing for a major modernization program, which will see its B-52s fitted with new radar, avionics, and powerful Rolls-Royce F-130 engines for increased efficiency and stealth. These upgraded Buffs will be redesignated as B-52Js and will be expected to carry out even more versatile roles, from a mothership for drone swarms to a return to the B-52's intended purpose as a nuclear weapons platform. It's fair to say that the Buff has earned legendary status among generations of airmen, with another quarter of a century of service left. The last generation of B-52 aircrew may not yet even be born.